Hey viewers, the other time we talked a little bit about rights, duties, obligations, interests, and justice. This time round, I want to believe that it's necessary to go through interests in a very, very quick and fast manner in order to grasp the legal meaning of interests. We usually use interests in many ways in ordinary conversations. When we talk to friends, we converse with our members of the family. We use interests such as I'm interested in this particular dish, I'm interested in this particular color, I'm interested. Well, it is something that makes me happy, makes me feel satisfied as a person. However, still, I would like to appreciate and acknowledge John Locke, John Stuart Mill, and Hugo Grotius, a Dutch jurist in the medieval period of time, for having developed a very, very inspiring and profound jurisprudence of property. You know, law is interested carefully about how we relate to things, the relationships that we create or created by law with the things, or what we call the outside world, but also the things within us. These are the things we refer to using the word property. Property that can be tangible or intangible. Tangible in terms of chattels, in terms of movable goods, and also immovable goods such as estates or real estates, lands, houses, or plots, or buildings. Those are all considered under property in which an individual can have interest in. May I look at it this way, that such property that are intangible can be considered abstract in terms of ideas. Even your ideas are your property, as well as the inventions, artistic skills, artistic discoveries and inventions. Anything that is considered property is within the property law. However, prior to the English and Dutch jurists at that time, there was already well-developed understanding of the Romans when it comes to property, when it comes to ownership and possession. The Romans, carefully under the Roman civil law, considered the rights we have or individuals have in relationship with things, with the outside world, in terms of animals, pets. Those are all considered as property that we can own and make claim of ownership over such things. That means we have interests, or individuals have got interests in such goods, and that makes them be property. But when it comes to human persons, there was a distinction. The Roman jurists referred to jus in rem. Rem comes from res. Those are things, these are objects of material world, things that we can own and claim possession over. Then that is how the law regulates how one can acquire property, one can acquire rights over property, one can appropriate and expropriate of property. But again, another distinction they created was jus ad personam. Jus ad personam means the interest we have in other persons. Remember that at that time, during the Roman time, in the Roman Empire, slaves were not considered as human beings. They were considered as objects that were owned by their slave masters, and they could be used to that effect. That has since been changed with the abolition of slavery and slave trade in the Western civilization. And we find that with the wording of Immanuel Kant, that a human person is an end in himself and not a means to an end. That means we cannot have interest in other human beings, but we have interest in relationship with the interests of other human beings. From this perspective, we can own properties and we can possess properties and we can use them. Utilitarianism, the usefulness of a good, is what makes its worth when it comes to the interest an individual has towards that property. I have interest, for instance, in purchasing a piece of land. Well, that means I have interest to purchase it. And once the purchase is done lawfully and I acquire through conveyancing the rights of ownership and the rights of possession, then I can make claims over that particular property because it belongs to me both by rights and by law. In this case, we can say that some properties we own them but we don't possess them. Some property we possess them but we don't own them. Some property we have both rights. So these are rights we are talking about, we have in things. And when we have rights of ownership but we lose or we don't have the rights of possession, then we can refer to the claims made on the right of lien. Lien comes from French, and that means the possessor is not the owner of the property, and the owner does not possess the property, yet the owner can make rightful claims over rights of lien to call back the property. That is seen in lending, in debt transactions, in borrowing. We find that you lend some property or you give some property to somebody who has not purchased it but is paying in installment. That property doesn't belong to the buyer at that point in time, but it belongs to the owner that can claim it back using the rights of lien. And the right of lien means that you can call it back to your possession at will when the transaction is not fulfilled according to the contract. Let's again look at the interests. Interests will come handy with persons. Only human persons and legal personalities have interests. This is explained under the law of persons or jus personam, in which natural persons refer to human beings, those who are born and will die at some point in time. However, they are not created by law. But law can create persons. These are known as legal personalities in corporations, body corporate in terms of companies, enterprises, registered bodies. And in that case, their coming into existence comes because of registration that puts them into legal existence. But when they get out of existence, we say they are winded up or they are no longer legally existing, then that is done procedurally through the law. There is that distinction, and both can borrow in their names and persons and bear responsibilities and liabilities at law. That means they can be sued or they can sue in the court of law. Within that regime, we also admit that interests transcend the use of rights However, still people use rights and interests interchangeably, but at law we need to distinguish between the use of interests and the use of rights in order to get the appropriate meaning. How do we appropriate goods to our ownership, to ourselves? How do we expropriate them? Or how are they expropriated? Well, if you have a motor vehicle, for instance, well, you are not using it and you want to give it to a friend who will then use it or keep it for you. That means you lose the possession rights, but you don't lose the ownership rights. If you use the conveyancing process, that means you convey certain rights of possession to the other party and you remain with the ownership rights. That means the property still by law and by right belongs to you, not to the possessor. The possessor is in custody and is caring of the property with the condition that the property belongs to you and you can make the claims over it. That means you have the interest as claim and you can claim it under the rights of lien. In that case, we can say that in robbery or in theft, a thief or the perpetrator has stolen the good from you. The perpetrator has only stolen the rights of possession, but not yet the rights of ownership. But if the thief or the perpetrator proceeds to transfer those rights illegally to his name, then you are robbed of both ownership rights as well as possession rights. In that case, you are very injured. You feel injured and damaged. The injury means that your interest has been interfered with and you need legal remedy. You need law to cure you. You are sick. In that case, you go to court. The perpetrator, if found guilty, will be convicted of forgery or of theft on different types of counts as charged in court. But in that case, the court will seek to restore your injuries and give you remedy, as well as awarding or compensating the damages caused in that process of action. This is how law gets in to regulate our relationships with things that can be immaterial or material, tangible or intangible, and also our relationships when it comes to other right holders, other personalities or people, persons, in terms of human persons and legal personalities. It is in this sense we understand the interest once again to mean claims or rights, legal rights that we have over such properties. It's about creating relationships. But also we have such similar relationships with our body organs. My body, for instance, belongs to me by natural rights, legal rights, and natural rights at the same time. In that case, it is me to dispose of any organ of my body, or I have to express my intent to dispose of it. If it is an eye, or maybe my heart, or a kidney, then I have to express my intent legally that I want to dispose it, or I want to donate it. So these are the things sometimes we say can be very complicated when it comes to the legal understanding of certain terminologies that we use ordinarily without caring about what they entail when it comes to the legal understanding. Thank you so much for watching this video. Peter here. University of Nairobi School of Law, Kisumu Campus. Remember to subscribe, and if you like it, share it. Bye for now.